Thank you for your help. Gary and I will start breaking down camp. If any more questions, now's the time to ask. We'll be gone once you get to it. Rhetoric says, if it's more cryptid-related business you want to discuss, you'll have time for that later, too. Inland Empire says, but what if the information is vital on the hunt? Tell me about this phasmid you're looking for. Well, first of all, it's damn difficult to find, which is why we've been knee-deep in the reeds laying traps for it. What makes it so difficult to find? Good question. Being a phasmid on the order Phantasmodea, a ghost insect, it disguises itself as plant matter. In this case, the reeds. He looks around. Awful lot of reeds around, aren't there? And I suspect it may have also developed other specialized techniques to protect itself from predators, or scientists in our present case. How big is this phasmid? I'm expecting it to be quite giant. One known species of phasmid called the Megaphasmodea zoenensis is about the size of a grown man's forearm. So, he leaves the conclusion up to you. What sorts of specialized techniques is the phasmid using to hide itself? It's my hypothesis that it has evolved certain electrochemical defenses that allow it to interfere with animal perception, impeding pattern recognition, confusing the visual cortex. But I cannot describe how these defenses work, much less how they evolved, without studying a live specimen. Conceptualization says, a ghost insect, he said. These people are looking for a ghost. So you're ghost hunters. No, that is precisely what we're not. We are zoological specialists looking for an extant species of phasmid. Why are you so interested in this stick bug? It doesn't seem to be as colorful as some of the other cryptids I've heard about. He flashes you a sideways smile. Typical rookie assumption. Insects are much more sophisticated creatures than those unversed in zoology give them credit for. Even simply catching a glimpse of the Insulinian phasmic would be the apex of any cryptozoologist's career, but to study it and its offenses, find out how it stayed hidden so long. He shakes his head. What have you discovered about it so far? Very little, I'm sorry to say. No one's ever captured a specimen, so all our information is based on first and third-hand accounts. So no one's ever found one? Not yet. He holds up an index finger. That's what makes it a cryptid. The lieutenant interjects, just out of curiosity. If there's no proof of its existence, how do you know it's real? I know it's real, the zoologist says, brusquely enough that even he seems taken aback by it. Rhetoric says, it's clear that his obsession with the phasmid is driven by something more than the pure pursuit of scientific advancement. By which I mean, he says, gathering himself, I've heard enough first-hand accounts to believe quite firmly that the Insulindian phasmid is more than mere superstition. Lena said there had been a sighting of it here in Martinez. Yes, the most recent sighting was by a couple of teenagers along the coast here. That's what brought us to Martinez specifically. It's the first credible sighting in several decades. Admittedly, it's an unusual location for this species, but with all the sewage runoff upstream, it probably doesn't matter much anymore. Maybe the Insulinian phasmid has died out? The cryptozoologist shakes his head vigorously. I have to resist the thought. Such an extraordinary creature is doubtlessly highly resilient. After all, it's generally thought to be capable of parthenogenesis. Encyclopedia says he means asexual reproduction. The females of the species don't need to mate to produce viable eggs. This makes it easier for a species with a small population to survive. That's pretty clever. Yes, the Insulinian phasmid is a very clever insect. That's why it's so damn difficult to catch. But as a scientist, I try my best to remain dispassionate. Let's talk about specific cryptids. He eyes you skeptically. All right, which cryptids, precisely? I don't usually discuss these things with specialists, so I don't know what... Rhetoric says we would have to discuss, he wants to say, but decides against it since you've offered to help. Suggestion says you need to ask him about specific cryptids, cryptids you've heard about from Lena or his friend Gary. He won't just talk. Your friend Gary told me about the burning rhino. Did he? He lowers his voice. That one's a hoax. Some surveys rice farmers set fire to rhinoceros cadavers and use them to scare tourists. Gary obliviously stares at the stage, safe in the knowledge the burning rhinoceros exists. Have you told Gary this? Many times. It always turns into an argument. I don't want to repeat it. The rhino holds a special place in his heart. Myths are part of my field. What if the other cryptids are hoaxes too? Many of them probably are. Statistically speaking, about 20% of all cryptids are verified hoaxes. Uncovering falsehoods deliberately fabricated to fool the public is just as much my calling as finding new species. Rhetoric says, if perhaps slightly less enjoyable. See, Kim? One of them is a hoax. Which one? He hasn't been paying attention. The burning rhinoceros. The burning rhino is where they draw the line. He's unimpressed. What if you're wrong? What if it's real? I doubt that. Once confirmed, the hoax, so-called sightings of the rhino stopped. A cough. Was there anything else, or... He won't tell us. We need to ask about specific ones. Which cryptid did you almost catch? You said before that you almost caught one. A willow person. It's a long story. One non-specialist would find rather dull. Conceptualization says willow people? Not at all. What are willow people? They're not people, really. Some argue that they're not even animals, as they seem to have evolved directly from trees. He says it in a self-explanatory, everyday manner. They're very, very thin, almost flat, in fact, and can camouflage themselves easily, wrapping themselves around trees and blending in with the tree bark. In that way, they're not too dissimilar from the phasmid we're looking for here. Wait, so I may have seen these willow people without knowing it? You probably have. How did you almost catch a willow person? Gary and I painted an entire grove's worth of trees in slow-drying paint. It was a bright lavender color. I was hoping one of the willow people would get paint on it and not be able to camouflage itself. After waiting and hiding for hours, I saw a figure slip from one of the trees, a lavender shadow dashing through the grove. And then? I chased it with a net. Not very elegant, but you can't be elegant in the field. And well, it was faster than me. A lavender shadow, Kim smirks. I know you think we're snacking on funny mushrooms. It's easier to mock someone than to admit that the world might be more interesting than you've imagined. Furthermore, he raises his finger, I am not saying it was a confirmed sighting. I am painfully aware of what goes into verifying such things. There's a serious possibility that I saw a squirrel or a trick of the light. I am my own harshest critic. Rhetoric says he makes it a real point here to sound falsifiable. And Lena's sighting of the phasmid, is that? Confirmed, he replies quickly. It's 100% verified and meets all the standards of an authentic cryptid sighting. So he won't tell me this, just tell me about a cool cryptid, any cryptid. No offense, officer, but I'm not much of a pedagogue. I don't know what I would have done if Lena hadn't persuaded me to go back to field research. You should ask her if you want interesting stories. Me? I'm not a people's person, unless you haven't noticed. And I don't make a good lecturer. My strength lies in field work and persistence. He brushes an errant strand of hair from his eye. Enough tales, then. Let's change the subject. By all means, he coughs and wipes his mouth. I'll get going. Alright, so... I can level up. I'm going to put into physical instrument. I want to see if we can take care of Measurehead without having to become someone that Kim will despise or might despise. Inspect the traps. Check the traps for Morel, this cryptozoologist, so he and his friend Gary can get some rest. There are 4 traps in total. After checking them all, return to Morel with the news. Okay, near the boathouse west of the Feld building. The trap Morel just set up in the cryptozoologist's camp. That one's last. The trap in Land's End just northeast of the Feld building. And the trap near the canal you cross southeast of the village. Alright. Talk to him again.
Hello again. Very generous of you to help us out, officer. I can't wait to get out of here.
Let's try this again. Analyze Gary's composure. Nope. Okay, he keeps shifting uncomfortably, but you can't make head or tail of this sound. And honestly, it's rude to stare, so stop. A buoy bobs in the water. The number on it says 11. I'm just saying, as a Revacholian, I am slightly worried. Oh, we came from here. It looks different with the snow. Oh, I got something here. Stop walking. How do we get there? Oh, we gotta run up. Necessity-driven architectural design at its finest. Feld. Oh, there's a Feld building. The fence blocks the path. No way on from here. Another power box. It charges nothing now. It's empty. Knows a Fed. Ooh, that's a good amount of money. 5.25 real. And 1.11. Lots of people out there missed the good old days. Let's talk to this guy. Oh, and his kid. Isn't this someone walking up here? Hmm. 50 years ago, this place was the heart of innovation. Oh, is this... That's, Kim. Never mind. Hello.
And Mikael, notice the windows. Especially with how there are no windows on the south side. This was to deal with.
A blind man stands next to his son, pointing to the weather-worn ruins. He sees you approaching and smiles.
You, officers, come to investigate the historic subtext of West Martinez. I'm Trant Heidelstan. You must be Kim Kitsuragi, right? I was just telling my son about this building. Not a lot of people realize the historic significance here. Very rich in hypertext.
Hypertext.
Nice to meet you.
The lieutenant nods. Hold on. Hypertext?
Yes, hypertext. Yankarp in the collection of cultural hyperlinks.
He says it as it's self-evident. What was that about the windows before?
Oh, yes. So, Mikael, they had to deal with monitor glare, especially in the summer. They still had vector monitors back then. That was 49 years ago, so they didn't have windows on the south wall.
Hmm. You and Kim know each other?
No, I can't say that we've met before, but I've heard of Kim, of course. Mikael, say hi to the officers.
He rests his hand on the boy's shoulder. The child stays hidden behind the hem of his father's coat, clutching to his worm-themed coloring book.
Mikael's a little tired today. We spent all night trying to run Orbis on his radio computer. Have you heard of it? It's a programming language used in Grodd. Quite tricky, but he wanted to play this Grodd-made adventure program. We've been getting really into worms lately.
As in dragons? Drama says the man speaks in the artificial cadence of a professor, or someone who's been on too many radio shows. Yeah, he's like he's announcing it.
But I assume you're not here for giant worms, when there are so many real things to see. Just as I was telling Mikael before, this is where the Coalition landed in 08. We could be standing on what is the most interesting landmark in Revachol West.
He points to the building again. Esprit de Corps says, this man is your half-brother. You feel it. But why? Half-brother? You mean literally? Encyclopedia says, wow, get a load of this guy. He really enjoys his trivia. The Orbis programming language was named after its inventor, Victor Orbis, a cybernetician from Grad. They run Vox in the Occidental countries. What's so fascinating about an empty old building? Aha! But it's not just any empty old building. He raises his hand to his eyes to shield himself from the freezing snow. All four of you turn to admire the mural before you. What not a lot of people know is, this used to be the R&D department of Feld Electrical, and Feld, which now sells ink cartridges mostly, was once a top dog in the turn-of-the-century cybernetics boom. Encyclopedia says, hold on, what's R&D? Encyclopedia doesn't know what that is. Research and development. What's the R&D department? Apologies, it's an acronym for research and development. They don't use it anymore. Oh, really? He smiles brightly, laugh lines around his eyes. Yeah, I see them. You're probably more familiar with RTD, Research and Technological Development. Encyclopedia says, mea culpa. You were not familiar with that one either. This man is a bookhead. Look at the building. It looks old and weathered, with seagulls picking apart its stone and metal carcass. Bushy undergrowth has taken hold of the collapsed rooftop. Some kind of bird has set up a nest on a broken windowsill. I don't think I've ever heard of this Feld Electrical. That's not surprising. Only a vestigial ink cartridge and ferrotape manufacturer remains. He adjusts his suit jacket. They started out as a midway electronics outfit in Königstein, two centuries ago. After an aggressive move to Revachol, Feld became a global player in the emerging personal electronics market of the pre-revolutionary era. Still, Tricentennial was beating them in business machines. He gestures toward the building, but Feld had an ace up in their sleeve, or should I say they were developing an ace up their sleeve. He grins. I'm mixing my metaphors here. What was that ace? It was here in Martinez, possibly in this very building, that they developed prototypes for, he pauses for effect, a tape computer. A tape computer? An elegant folding mechanism of rollers and ferrotape ribbons, portable enough to be a take-it-home solution, revolutionizing business machines, possibly even bringing them to the average consumer. Which is a feat of engineering even today's giants Ream, ICN, and ZAM haven't achieved yet. He grins, admiring the sentence he just produced. What happened? Indeed, what? Trant says. I guess that's the boy. Oh, Trant is the guy. No, mind. Mikael? I think is his name? Pronounce it? Not Mikael, like I would think. Mikael, I believe he said. The revolution? The boy wipes his nose on his sleeve. Trant nods. Unfortunately, their moonshot project never made it to the market. Feld's move to Revachol backfired. The revolutionary government liquefied their assets and expropriated those very advanced prototypes, possibly from this very building or one of the adjacent ruins. He pauses, pointing to the other building, then continues. All of this was built by Feld, even the boardwalk. Wild Pines built Martinez proper as a resort for their middle management. Feld built this side of town for R&D. How did those tape computers work? Actually, no one knows. No one even knows what a computer made entirely of tape would look like. Seriously? I didn't think it was made of tape. But word has it they were very elegant, exquisite, alien-looking turn-of-the-century hardware. He raises his finger, remembering something. Encyclopedia says, buckle up. 10 years ago, I did a little freelancing, I guess you could say. I was a special consultant for an exhibition at the Wompty Dompty Dom Center in Redfort, Aranye. It raised the same questions, and we had lengthy discussions with Paul Ackerman, who was head curator at the time. This was before the twins Keith and Guy, Juiced, joined the team, trying to... Reaction speed, wait. Did he just say Wompty Dompty Dom Center? Suggestion says he did it. He said Wompty Dompty Dom Center like it's the most natural thing in the world. Encyclopedia says, what the hell is a Wompty Dompty Dom Center? And who the hell are Keith and Guy Juiced? Okay. Wompty Dumpty Dom Center, Paul Ackerman, Keith and Guy Juice, what are you talking about? The Center for Contemporary Arts. I'm not going to say all that over and over again. There it is again, those words. The exhibition itself drew on Lagerman's notion of memory, and so there were some parallels. That's why the head curator, Paul Ackerman, chose to... Come on, there is no place called the Wompty Dumpty Dom Center of Arts. Actually, I think there is. Kim pauses. No, it's too much. He's joking. Thought gained for Wompty Dumpty Dom Center. In fact, I'm not. The center, he says casually, is a place where you can visit if you're ever in Vredefort and are ever in the market for an exhibition space slash contemporary art research center. But perhaps I should return to the tape computers. As I was saying, the device itself was very elegant, fragile even. One could write directly on the tape using a special chemical solution. The machine would then analyze the handwriting, perform operations, and project output onto a white screen. It was a beautiful, delicate thing. Conceptualization says, made of black film and folding tape structures. The RCM should get some of those. Even one would be very useful, he agrees. Though I understand the socio-economic causes of the revolution, it pains me to imagine the revolutionaries setting fire to this precious device. But so they did. The Feld playback experiment vanished into the fires of 07. Does this ever end? Wait, the Feld playback experiment? Yes, the official name of the prototype. Some sources report it as the Feld playback experience, but those are incorrect. Why did the revolutionaries destroy it? Who knows? Maybe it was an accident. Maybe they didn't want the technology to end up in the wrong hands. Either way, they're all gone now. All three versions of the prototype. Nothing but debris and ashes remains inside that building. He takes a step back. The boardwalk creaks mournfully in the wind. What did the revolutionaries do with these advanced tape computers? They used them for military communications, he says, while his son looks up, idly chewing on the corner of his worm-themed coloring book, but also to write and send out press releases, the most notorious example being Le Decret de Mar. What was that? What's the March Decree? I mean... Is that what means? Oh, March Decree, the Decree of March. I mean, the radio transmission sent out to news agencies and world governments by the newly created commune of Revachol on the 7th of March in the year 02. Encyclopedia says, a short-lived legislative foundation for a short-lived utopia. It's a beautiful piece of text, actually. A singer-songwriter I know, Charette, called a love poem to Revachol on her political concept album, Bon Baiser d'Insulinde. You should read it. Every local library in Revachol stocks a copy of the decree. I tried to get Mikael to memorize it. I hope I'm saying that right. He looks at his son, who starts giggling, his face hidden behind the book. Oh well, tried to. Someone was much too interested in worms to be paying any attention. What happened to the engineers, the company people? Oh, I'm afraid it didn't end well for the boys. He smiles again, as if he's somehow personally responsible for this bleak turn of events. But this story is a bit too dark for little Mikael here. Now, if you were asked about tape computers... I already have. Rhetoric says, wait, is he saying that we should just bypass the excesses of the revolution? Tape computers, right. Tape computers, he nods. Wind tussling his suit jacket. Yeah, I guess we don't want to talk about that around the boy. I can respect that. You're saying that Feld Electrical built this boardwalk? Yes, they even built a pleasure wheel, but that got destroyed in the war. A pleasure wheel? The lieutenant looks wistfully at the horizon, as if picturing gondolas rising to the sky. Empathy says, perhaps reminded of a childhood memory? It's clear he would prefer there were a big wheel lighting up the coast. Yes, to lure in their star engineers. This part of Martinez was nothing but reeds before Feld arrived. They had to make the prospect of living here attractive. It was supposed to become a global center for innovation in cybernetics, but history had other plans. I want to ask something else, but of course, what else? He smiles and ruffles his kid's head. You look like someone who has money. Do you have any money? I do have some money, yes, but that's not what's really important here. He brushes it off like it's not a thing at all. Authority says, he's not going to give you money. What are you doing? Clearly you were just profiling. Rhetoric says, no, I mean, come on, you need the money. If it's not a thing, he can give you some. Could I have some of that unimportant money, then? Oh, no, I don't have it on me, officer. I was talking in more general terms. He looks uncomfortable, his left hand squeezing his son's shoulder. I'm just spending time with my kid here, showing him around the lesser-known parts of our hometown. It wouldn't be wise to carry huge amounts of cash on such expeditions. Physical instrument says, not they would have to worry about being robbed. He looks surprisingly buff. Does he work out? By the way, do you work out? I do some low man thing stick fighting now and then. Encyclopedia says, low man thing stick fighting is a form of martial arts originating from the Isle of Low Man Thing. Makes sense. It uses slender wooden sticks for confronting the opponent. A form of martial arts from the Isle of Low Man Thing, right? Actually, quite many cultures have their own version of stick fighting, such as the sacred Mabalo tradition of the Halley people, the name deriving from the butterfruit tree traditionally used for crafting the long, slender sticks, whereas the sticks used in other cultures. You doze off as he paints you a comprehensive picture of the history of stick fighting among the mankind, seasoning it with unexpected pop culture references. Rhetoric says, man, he's good at speaking. People must love him. But anyway, he says after a while, with a charming, apologetic smile, I am boring you with details again, you were saying? I'm not really interested in the practice, I just want to know how often you work out. Like, now and then? That's what, like, twice a week? Lomantang stick fighting is a little like a pyroholodon addiction. Sure, I'm not saying that right. He explains with a little smile, I've been practicing it for nearly 20 years now, so you could say that my doses have grown a little peculiar. Empathy says, wait, what does this man know about pyroholodon addiction? Hold on, pyroholodon addiction? What an interesting metaphor. Or perhaps not a metaphor at all? You got me, detective. He chuckles before a shadow takes hold of his face. But my history should hardly come as a surprise. Authority says, here's a former junkie. I can recognize one when I see it. Mikael says, suddenly opens his mouth, Dad's fighting with sticks every night after dinner for 4 hours. He has a special room for that, and a special costume. That's right, Mikael. Trant grabs his kid into single-handed embrace, happy to change the subject. It also has a meditative quality, helps to clear my head. But anyway, he says, swaying with his hand. Great. Thank you for all the interesting information. No, thanks to you for having me and my little Mikael here to pick your brain. A very interesting conversation indeed. Rhetoric says, pick your brain? If anything, this is rather one-sided. He did the talking. Whatever. Okay. I'm glad that's over. Bars cover these long, dusty windows. The remaining windows rattle from a strong gust of wind, our hearing perception says. They're covered in a thick layer of grime. They must have been like this for 40 years. Try to see inside. Dripping water falls from a high place. All you can see is a shadow of a collapsing staircase. Visual calculus says there's rust and corrosion out of the bars. They're foaming with it, and a small layer of white salt from the sea. Lieutenant, could you make out what's inside? No, he shakes his head. The windows rattle in their frames. I won't even try. You know? He takes his glasses off. I had a partner once. They called him Eyes, because he had to show me things. Is that bad? Can you still shoot, though? Well enough, actually. It's odd how that works. I'm no sharpshooter, but I pass my shooting courses 7 out of 10. Okay, and here we've got fair weather. Oh no, Wompty Dompty Dom Center. It's Wednesday evening, and something heinously exciting is underway. People have gathered beneath the billowing roof of an oddly shaped trophy building, sipping wine and exchanging opinions. 29-year-old Wonder Twins Guy and Keith Juiced are the stars of the show, with their bomber jackets and white sneakers, head curators of this art exhibition. It's the wompty-dom-de-dommiest event of the year, and all the cool kids have RSVP'd. Where are you, if you're not there? Indeed. Can't go in there yet. Someone has left an unidentifiable article of clothing on this railing. It smells really bad. The cloth, if you can still call it that, makes a soft crunching sound as you thrust your finger into it. It's streaked with dried seagull crap and tangled with pieces of seaweed. A dangling arm suggests that there might be a jacket beneath the crust of filth. Logic says it seems likely that it was left in the surf until someone laid it out on this bench to dry out. Unfortunately, that just seems to have stiffened it into a shapeless mass. Kim says, please tell me you're not taking that with you. I think this is the jacket the idiot Doom Spiral guy wanted me to find. Lieutenant looks at the stinking rag and sniffs. I'm sure he'll be thrilled to have it returned. Filthy jacket. Was an interactable thing. This filthy rag has been at the mercy of the elements for quite some time. It's streaked with seagull crap and abnormally stiff from God knows what natural processes. You can't even tell what brand it is. As you hold it in your hands, it makes an uncomfortable crunching sound. Man, how did this jacket get so disgusting? It's a sordid and filthy tale, not for the weak. Are you sure you can stomach it? Think about it. It occurs to you that you're not even holding the jacket itself, but rather the thick crust of jetsam and seagull crap that ensconces it. Gross. Composure says, why? Why did you think about it? Look at your hands. They're covered in muck. Ew, ew, ew. Flick your hands. Damage morale. Now you're just flicking that crap everywhere. This is a disaster. You'll never get the smell out. Oh, brother. Let's heal that. Why did I fondle the crap jacket again? There's no why. Let's just put it away then. Okay. What about this? Some money and plastic. A makeshift roof. Vagrants have tried to make the boardwalk habitable. That tarp will keep out neither rain nor snow nor wind. What have we got here? A postcard for Koran 33. This one has hell written on its back. It could not be farther from the truth. It's the boom years, and Koran, the nicest district in Revachol West, is enjoying a sun-drenched day. Tall and handsome buildings rise from the riverside, steel, iron, and yellow limestone, with cloud shadows sliding on the facades. A coin-operated weighing machine. Hasn't been used for a decade. Vagrants have recently painted the tarp red. Water drips from it. Ooh. Mega Binos prescription lenses? Whose idiotic idea were square and beige plastic frames anyway? Beige is a color that does not look good on anyone, not to mention that seeing the world through these exceedingly thick lenses feels almost nauseating. Well, we get +2 encyclopedia, discover your inner bino, and -1 perception for nausea-inducing L glasses. I'll just hold on to them. Oh, we got here. Nice. Some bottles. Someone must have worked hard to smash this plastic dome. A metal payphone under a yellow plastic dome. You could use it to call someone, unless you're out of change. Up the handset. You hear the tone. The machine is operable. It's only 10 cents. We should save our money, but dial a random number. Calling. Still calling. Inland Empire says, this feels wrong. Should you be doing this? End of tone. Someone picks up. Pierre? Is that you, Pierre? The voice is female and sounds about 100 years old. Yes, it's me, Pierre. So nice of you to find the time to call me. Gets so lonely. Even the animals have died. That's not good. Are you sure you're Pierre? Your voice. It's different. Chrysanthemum. Her voice is drowned in white noise. Sounds like waves washing a beach, growing in volume until the call suddenly disconnects. Inland Empire says, you get a sinking feeling. It makes you look to see if Lieutenant Katsuragi overheard you. To your relief, he did not. I don't see why we keep calling random numbers. Especially when we need the money. What's this? Oh, the glasses? A dead phone, a smashed receiver, like someone hung up too hard. And I think we've been over here. Yeah, that's the smash thing. Carriage. The sign reads St. Brune, 1147. You feel the shadow of a very large building fall on you. Dusty pews in the shadows. Many seem to be missing. An altar shrouded in dark, or something like that. It's too dark to tell. Okay. I guess next episode we'll be seeing if we can go inside here, which is the church. Yeah. Almost the whole day has gone by. Just exploring. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time, and always seek adventure.